Hey guys, welcome to our 10-week challenge, Design Your Physique. Some of you are non-members, so welcome for your first time. And those of you who have been training with us for a while, it's great that we can offer you something like this to keep you motivated and help you achieve your goals that you set out to achieve. This is going to be a basic talk on how to create your own meal plan. Okay, so I want to give you the tools, I want to empower you with the knowledge and information that you need to create a food plan that's sustainable, okay, achievable, and it's healthy. Very important to remember, it's got to be healthy. The sustainable part of your food plan needs to be something that you can follow beyond the 10 weeks. It's not a crash course dieting system. We don't cut the calories right out and then binge. It's not that kind of program. What we want to do is teach you how to eat correctly for the rest of your life. Some of you know some of you have received meal plans from me, and you've seen those three elements are always there in the meal plans. It's always sustainable. We can keep doing this. It's healthy because we can keep doing it for the rest of our lives. And what I do is I try to get to a meal plan balance based on your lifestyle, your work schedule, etc. Recently, I've been doing three meals a day because I've noticed that a lot of people work better with three meal system: breakfast, lunch, dinner. I noticed that more and more people have less time on their hands, so we try to keep it simple. And that's the achievable part. We must choose the amount of meals that you can follow on a daily basis consistently. So it needs to fit into your lifestyle. And then healthy part, all food's made up of energy nutrients and element nutrients, the nutrients that are gonna assist your body's chemical reactions and functioning properly. So we've got macronutrients, which are the energy ones, and then micronutrients, which are the other ones. These are the ones that we need to have abundant amount for us to be healthy, so that all the chemical reactions in the body can work properly. So what we're going to do to begin with, and you'll probably be able to take some notes while we go through, but I'm going to just talk you through what kinds of food to eat, and then I'm going to go to how much of those foods to eat. In the past, I've done a seminar on the 21-day challenge we did. It was cutting out of grains, cutting out of alcohol, all sugars. What else? We cut out fruit for 3 weeks. Dairy was another one we cut out for 3 weeks. And Sue, I think, how much did you change in 3 weeks?
Yeah, lots of it.
Heaps. So a few of those food groups that I've named are the kinds of foods that if you eat a lot of, you probably won't be able to achieve excellent fat loss results. So what we're going to do immediately, because most of you are here for fat loss results, I'm going to say, don't eat grains. All right? So write that down. There are some grains that I use with some of my clients, but for the purpose of what we're doing, I'd say eliminate all the grains from your diet. So that's the first one. Alcohol is another one.
I'm leaving it.
All right. So that's those two are the enemy. I'll quickly give you some info on grains. Our bodies are so amazingly designed, but when we eat grains, the grain itself is held with a kind of protein that keeps us from absorbing all the nutrients that are stored and locked up in it. That's not to say that there's not nutrients in it, it's to say that we can't actually access those nutrients. So what happens is inside of our intestine we have this war going on, a bacterial war, trying to get this out, but we can't. So we have things like bloating, we have gas, we have fatigue, we have malabsorption, and they're also very dense in calories, especially carbohydrates, and so they tend to raise insulin, and then they tend to put more body fat on. So grains we're trying to eliminate. Alcohol is an empty nutrient. It's a real horrible one. It wreaks havoc in your body, and it really wrecks your endocrine system, which is your hormonal system. We want to try to eliminate alcohol through the 10-week program. After that, having a little bit here and there is okay. We want to be able to have a lifestyle, I understand that, but if you know exactly what alcohol is doing in your body, you probably drink a lot less of it. I'll write an article on that and perhaps even run a seminar on that specific. Yep, it's that big that I actually feel like I want to stand in front of you and tell you all the negative things about it. So those two things we want to avoid. And then we're going to limit dairy. Dairy is definitely, I've noticed when they're working with people, as soon as I drop the dairy, they start to get results. They start to lose body fat. Their skin improves immediately, and fatigue. All those things that are around feeling horrible are usually connected to the food that you eat. Okay, and dairy is one of those big ones. So there are a few that you can try to keep in. So like soft cheese and yogurt, you can try to keep that in. But if you want to be perfectly healthy or healthiest, then I would cut it out completely. Question?
Coconut milk.
So coconut milk is just because it's milk doesn't mean that it's dairy. Okay? So there are alternatives to dairy. However, you must remember that you must not eat too many calories. So there's so many alternatives. We've got, like, when I sometimes see some of these sweets and cakes and treats and alternatives to wheat-based, dairy-based treats, they've got like double the calories. So you need to remember that just because it's gluten-free or whatever free, it doesn't mean that it's going to be healthier. You'll probably end up messing up your endocrine system. When you've got high levels of insulin in your body, we've got somebody in here who we've been talking about that. High levels of insulin in your body leads to type 2 diabetes. Type 2 diabetes is a dangerous disease. Okay? So we want to try to keep insulin levels low. So don't just opt for the healthy option without knowing what calories are in there, what sugars are in there, and what effect it's going to have on your endocrine system. Okay, so those three things. We're going to eliminate grains, we're going to try to reduce and limit our dairy, and alcohol, try your best to eliminate that as well. Let me see what else I've got on here. Okay, so those are the... Yeah, those are the three avoids. Now, I always start with the proteins. Proteins are important. It's an essential nutrient. Our bodies need it for survival. So proteins are always something that I'll put first when I list out a group of foods to eat in a meal. And good choices of proteins will be chicken, turkey, beef and lamb, pork. I don't eat a lot of pork, but pork's okay. Hey man, how are you?
Yeah. What's why pork sort of okay?
All right, I'll tell you about pork.
Yeah.
So there are some foods like pork and seafood that like shellfish that contain enzymes in that cause the meat to decompose fast, so it's accelerated decomposing meat, and that's why I don't eat a lot of it, because it doesn't stay fresh for long. So beef is probably the best one, but chicken, turkey is very good as well. Lamb, very good. Fish is good, but also I try to avoid eating too much of it. Okay, we've got contaminated sea waters and so eating a little bit of fish is okay. You get the white fish, which is low in fat, and then you've got the oily fish, which is high in fat. Okay, you'll figure out when you start using your app. You put a fish, let's say salmon, you put that in, and you notice your fats shot up. And you're like, what? That will teach you. You'll understand. Oh, okay, so it's got this much percentage of that, this much percentage of that. But then you put barramundi in and it'll be like different. Okay? Chicken breast, for instance, very different from mackerel. Okay? But they both got protein, but one's got lots of fat. I'll go through that in a second. Okay, next. So I said oily fish and eggs. Eggs are not your enemy. Eggs are probably the best food on the planet. And they actually contain something called lecithin, which helps to reduce cholesterol in your body. So it helps to reduce your bad cholesterol, increase your good cholesterol. You want that in your diet. I'll eat about 6 eggs every single day. And at some stages, I've had 24 eggs a day. 24 eggs a day. So, and for me, I know the benefits of eating eggs. And the cholesterol that's in the eggs is really helps to support your endocrine system, your hormonal system. So, especially for guys, not many in here, but eggs on a daily basis really help to support testosterone that we need so much. Okay?
Dave, just out of curiosity, brand of eggs, do you have a specific brand? Because there's such a variety coming out in supermarkets at the moment.
Yeah, I don't have a brand for you. What you're always going to be looking for, everything free roaming. So you don't want like caged hens where they've got no light on them. They need to be free. Everything is free roaming. So as healthy as you can. I understand that we shop at Coles and Woolworths, and this isn't a discussion today about the most perfect organic choice. This is just giving you basics on what kind of food to eat, and so yes, but that's like Kay walked in with grass-fed
beef
yesterday, and I was like, perfect. She understands that the grass-fed is better than the corn-fed. Okay. So, and, but that's definitely another long discussion. All right. So fats are very important. So we've got proteins. We've got fats. The fats are the next ones. Good fats. Now in meat. Contains a lot of fat, and don't be alarmed about the saturated fat in meat. That's okay. It's part of nature. That's how we're supposed to be eating the meat. But some of the fats that you can add to your meals to bring your fat levels up will be avocado, coconut, and coconut oils. Sometimes we'll cook with butter, olive oil. Nuts and seeds, my favorites, are walnuts and almonds.
So if I can ask a question, because you said for me at the moment, don't really eat the nuts. Why is that?
Nuts and seeds, again, are similar to your grains, which are harder for your body to break
down.
So I can give someone a food plan that has no nuts, no seeds, and just based on vegetables and fruits, and they'll have best digestion and best absorption and highest micronutrient uptake and highest nutrition intake.
Yeah.
So it just, no one's the same.
Yeah.
I'm just giving you
overall.
It's like a general. Yeah. But if I'm working with you individually and you're doing something slightly different, that's okay, because you're an individual and I've had the time to spend with you to choose what foods to do for you. Okay. As I said, yogurt, coconut yogurt's a great alternative for that. Okay. And we need to have fat in the diet. Fat's a great way to get energy into the body without it affecting your insulin. So you could eat fat to make up your calories for your energy and intake, which will bring the micronutrients into your body without affecting a dangerous hormone. Insulin. Insulin isn't always dangerous. It's just dangerous when it's in high amounts and it's circulating through your bloodstream and your body's not taking it and using it. So we don't want to have elevated insulin levels. Okay? So fats are a great way to do that. And you'll see with a breakdown when I give you your portion amounts, you'll understand how to use fats for energy. Okay, and then the carbohydrates. Very, very simple, and everyone will know this from all the years of working with me, all the months of working with me. It's vegetables and fruit at specific times, but at this stage, fruit and veggies. Now, veggies, you can have, there's so many. The best ones are the the cruciferous. So that would be broccoli, Brussels sprouts, cauliflower. Yummy. I love them. I used to hate veggies when I was a child. I couldn't eat them. I used to gag and I just couldn't eat them. And then I started learning about nutrition and understanding what they do inside my body. And now I just eat them. I eat them. I enjoy eating them. So I started eating them, forced myself to eat them. And now I'm always looking for veggies on my plate. It would always be like, what are we having? What veggie are we having? You know, that's where the micronutrients are going to come from.
Yeah, cauliflower is great to replace rice.
Yeah, good point. Yes. So zucchini and cauliflower, you can do cool stuff with those things. All right, so that's what to eat. And now how much we're going to go through this. This is probably going to be confusing at first, but you have to ask questions as we go through this, and I can ease the information into your head. All right, so we've got to eat the right amount of food. It's so important. If you eat too much food, regardless of whether it's good food, it's going to make you fat, okay? And that's the truth. Too many calories is going to increase body fat. Simple. You can eat the wrong kinds of food at the right amount, and that can also make you store body fat. So if you had 1,000 calories of sugar, all right, even though it's underneath what your body requires for the day, you'll probably still get fat because it's wrecking what's going on in your body. So your body's malfunctioning, so it'll lead to like a bad result. So let's do this. You want to use a calorie counter, something like MyFitnessPal. Once you spend 20 minutes on it, you'll start to understand what's going on. And I'm going to try to help you explain how to balance out your nutrients. So the other one, I showed you a different one.
No, I've got MyFitnessPal. The one you sent me, I couldn't find.
Diet. There's so many. Diet. I'm not sure. I can't remember. Obviously, I was using one, and I can't remember the name for it. But MyFitnessPal is fantastic. And it's easy to use, isn't it?
Mm. If anyone needs a hand downloading it or using it, then come and see me.
It's got a scanner, so you can also scan certain foods.
Wow. Yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is what we're going to do. We need to work out how much your body needs. Okay? You need to have a goal that you're going to work towards. And this is, we easily get this by determining what your basal metabolic rate is. That means that the amount of calories you need at rest, the amount of calories your body needs on a daily basis before you exercise, before you throw in any kind of lifting and stuff. So now this is easy. You can do this online, find heaps of calculators. But another way to do it for guys, you can just take your body weight and times it by 24. Girls, you can take your body weight and times it by 20. It's just like a rough. It's quite close. Now, the other thing, because I've been working with people for so long,
if you said body weight times 20, if you lose 5 kilos, then would you use your new body weight and drop your calories, or?
Exactly. It means that every 2 weeks you should do it again, work it out again. Once you've lost some weight, you need to reestablish how much you're meant to eat, okay? But over the years I've been working with people, that's why I'm giving you a rough guide, because those real textbook numbers, they don't always give you the result. You've got to feel it. You've got to feel what works for you. You've got to learn. It's like, and then when I work with people one-to-one, I'm watching them, I'm watching their energy, I'm watching their performance, and then I'm making adjustments if I can see things are not working right. I'm looking at their results, and this is just keeping the finger on the pulse kind of thing. So we start off somewhere and then we just start to tweak things. And you must understand that what you set up for this week may change next week. So let's use me as an example. I will go with the basic system. I'll put my body weight in, let's say I'm 90 kilos, times that by 24. Okay, 2160, that's the calories I need. Daily basis. So I wouldn't diet on less than that.
That's non-workout?
Yeah,
or workout?
Non-workout. I wouldn't diet on less than 2,160. And on what I would then do is I would put my activity on top of that. Let's say I'm training once a day for an hour. I'll add 500 calories to that. Or if you're only training three times a week, then you must only add 250 divided over the week. Right? Or you can do training days, non-training days. Lots to it. But let's just go with this 2160. This is my calorie amount. So what I want to then do is add my exercise to this. Let's say I'm going to do the hour. I'm going to add 500 to that. It's going to give me 2,660. And let's say my goal is to reduce body fat. What should I do?
Take out some calories.
Perfect. So I don't want to go right down to my BMR, which is 2,160. So I'll just come down under, something under. How much do you think?
Take away
250. 250 is good. About
2, 3.
Yeah. Under like 250 down from that. Maybe 10%. So 10%. Okay. And then what I'll do is I'll follow that for 7 days and see how I feel and see how I've changed and make a decision. If I feel exhausted, I've done too much or I've eaten too little. You must understand that everything we do is sustainable. It's got to last a lifetime. And then you adjust that. Okay, so let's go with questions. Does everyone understand that what I've just done? And if you have a question, it's not going to be like a silly question. If you're not sure 100% of what I'm talking about.
I think the one thing I felt like my fitness pal was awesome, but the hard part for me was figuring out, you know, because it asks you to put in what percentage of protein, fats and carbohydrates you want. So like that was the tricky
thing
to figure
point,
out.
Yeah. Okay, so that's the next point. So first we work out calories and how much to have. If you're very active, you need to put more on. Now, some of these online calculators will suggest to you if you do 5 hours of training, put in 1.7 or 1.5, times about 1.5. If some of them, if you're very sedentary and you only train very little, then you'll only increase by a little. Okay? But then it comes, you work that amount, the calorie amount, and now you've got to get the macro breakdown, energy breakdown in that. Let's use something really simple. Let's say I have to diet on 3,000 calories. Now I want to build muscle, so I go to 3,000 calories. With the muscle building program, I want to have about a 40% of my diet coming from protein, 40% of my diet coming from carbohydrates, and 20% coming from fat. If, for instance, I want to lose fat, then what I want to do is maybe decrease the carbohydrates, increase the fats. So the same 40, 40, 20, but it'll be different because your fats are at 40 and your carbs are at 20. All right. Am I going too fast? I'm looking at lots of faces. I've got lots of questions.
We're trying to process.
Okay. All right. Let me start it again. All right. Try to simplify. You have to eat a certain amount of food, all right? In that food, you've got nutrients that your body needs. If you eat too little, if you eat too little, you're not gonna get those nutrients. So you have to establish how much your body needs right now, because it's a certain size or it's a certain shape. You have to eat like that to be healthy, all right? Does that make sense? So that's why I'm spending time on how much to eat. Very important to get those calories in. The next part is with...
Sorry, was it?
Yep, if you want to build.
And then all those, like, 40 protein, 40 fat, and 20 carbs.
That's good. Yeah. All right, and out of that amount that you're eating on a daily basis, you have to divide it up into those separate nutrients, those macronutrients. It has to be separate. You can't only eat 3,000 calories of protein. You can't only eat 3,000 calories of carbohydrates, fats. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. All right, let's just simplify and go... If you were to divide it equally, 33% on each, if I had a 3,000 calorie diet, that means I'd have 1,000 calories in protein, 1,000 calories in carbs, and 1,000 calories in fats. Questions before I move on?
What?
I think one of the things that is interesting for people to realize too is that probably most people are not eating enough. So like when I have worked with I'd always been around 1,200 calories, 1,400 calories for years, and actually I was supposed to be eating about 2,000 something for the amount of training I was doing. So there is an adjustment, I think, when you go, but you realize it's just you're adding a lot more vegetables, a lot more, you know, a bit of fruit and stuff like that. So most people will probably end up eating more than they're used to, and that takes a little bit to get used to.
I think Kay's understanding that as well.
Yeah.
Exactly. And the fruits and veggies are a great way to up your calories. Okay?
My question is, because Drew's only just joined with you, so he was eating the same as me when I started and had a massive weight loss in the 6 weeks. What happens then if he's used to eating and he feels really full on like foods that I'm eating, or the quantity and portions, now that he's with you, you might be asking him to actually eat more. Does he put on weight because after 6 weeks he's been eating the same as me and then he eats more? And
No, and especially because he's exercising now, he's going to require more calories.
Okay.
He's going to require more. So,
because for him, the conversation is, well, I can't eat any more than I'm already eating.
You'll be hungry when you're training.
Yeah.
You will. Your body will ask you for more food.
Yeah.
That's why it's like that. Your body will ask you. You've got to listen to your body. You've got to find what works for you. This is great, and having all this information, but really, once you learn it once, you do it once, you wouldn't need to do it again. It's hard to get the understanding, the amount of food, the division, but then once you've got that, you just guess in the future, you'll know, like, that's too much, that's right, that's too little. Be like Goldilocks.
Yeah.
All right, you'll just know, and that, oh, this is perfect for me. I feel that's it, perfect. You feel it, you'll just know. Okay? So let's get back to the breakdown. So you've got three macronutrients we're working with: proteins, fats, and carbohydrates. And if you had to divide them a third each, that'll be 33%. Okay, so if you're on 3,000 calories, it'll be 1,000 each. Okay? Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So if it's 2,000 that you need to have, divide that into three. Yep, like 660 something. If it's 1,500, it's only 500 each. Okay, and then, so this is what I suggest. For your first week, make it simple, divide each equally. Very simple. Once you understand that 33% of each, then week two, up your protein a little, drop your carbs a little, okay? You can start to play around with those numbers. Say, oh, if I increase my chicken, I'm gonna have more protein. If I decrease my avocado, less fat, carbs, sweet potato, oh cool, look at that. And then you can start to play around. Right, so the ratio is important now. So to write these down, it's a third for your first week. Once you have got the hang of that, you wanna change it. For fat loss, we wanna decrease the carbohydrates in our diet. For fat loss, only 20% carbs. Where do the carbs come from?
Fruit and veg.
Yeah, fruit and veg, and especially veg. Veggie.
Pumpkin.
Yeah, it's a veg.
Can you just go back to your fruits? What fruits you're recommending?
Fruits, you know, I like fruits because they're full of nutrients. Timing on fruits is important. Right now, don't worry too much because it's really calories that you're looking at for now and carbohydrate intake. When we get to week five, I can then tell you about timings. But all fruits, good. Just eat it for now. Make sure to hit your calorie targets.
You're not worried about some fruits having more sugar than others?
So, okay, all fruit contains sugar.
Yeah.
All right. And some fruit contains more fructose than glucose, because that's what it's made up of, those two, all right? But right now, don't make it too detailed or too complicated. Learn one thing, do that right. Learn the next thing, do that right, and then we'll move on to that. Okay, but like, I don't want to confuse you with too many details. What's most important is what to eat, okay? How much to eat. At the end of this, you need to be able to tell me, you understand, what to eat and how much to eat. But fruit is part of those foods that you should be eating. Any questions before I go?
reflect on that.
All right, so I'll tell you the importance of this and doing this. You must have heard someone say in your lifetime that you are what you eat. Okay, and it's true, but it's not 100% true. What's true is your body composition, your health, is a result of what you eat. Okay, your body composition and your health is a result of what you eat and do. Okay, your lifestyle must change for you to change. Things must change if you want to change. Things will never change unless you change first. Okay, and I use food to get incredible results for people. I have done for 17 years, and it's a massive part of Design Physique and the results that we've achieved with all our members. So it's not something that it's just like, oh, we're having a chat about food, and if you could do it, do it. If you don't do it, it's not. This is the most important part of getting yourself healthy and achieving the results with your body composition, changing the way you feel about the way you look. Okay? So, I'm going to wait for you to think about some stuff that we've been talking about, you're not 100% clear about. I want to give you the time to then ask these questions that you have, because before you go out, I want you to be confident that you know what you're going to do in a grocery store, and then tomorrow what you're going to do when you're preparing your food. Okay? And then after that, we'll go through a bit of preparation tools and tasks. Yes?
One question.
No.
Good.
Okay. All right. So that's an excellent question, because I think that the industry is nuts. People selling breakfast cereals, they'll make you believe that you got to eat breakfast and then you got to eat their cornflakes and whatever. Breakfast is the same as every other meal. It's a time when you take food into your body. Okay. And they call it a breakfast because you break in a fast from the previous night, you've been sleeping all night, and you eat. The first meal is your breakfast. So you could have that meal at midday, okay, or you could have it in the afternoon at 3. You could have longer periods of fast. This is technical stuff. This isn't something that I would just say, I'll go and try this intermittent fasting. It's something that you would do with a coach, a professional, an expert. Okay, but no, don't have to eat breakfast, but you do have to eat the right amount of food. The right amount of food, not too much and not too little. Good.
Is there any science then, David, in eating kind of more at the start of the day and less towards the end of the day? So you quite often hear people say don't eat anything after 7 o'clock or whatever.
Okay, so yes, I've had amazing results with people doing that kind of eating. That kind of system. So the science is actual results. That's how, and I've been working with people so long and so many people, that that's a system that I know works. So I give it to a lot of people. But in saying that, you don't have to do it like that. It's just the same as what I was just saying. You can eat it, you can eat differently. You've got to eat the right amount. Now the easiest way, most simple, is just to split your calories equally, morning, midday, and dinner time. That's very easy. But if you can't do that, two meals a day can work. Lunchtime, half your calories. Dinner time, half your calories. Or you could have lunchtime with a small snack and then your dinner time. I eat, everybody knows how I only leave here at like 7, and I have to be here 5:30. So when I get home, 7:15, 7:30, I'm eating. I'm in bed at 8:30. Okay? And then if you go and speak to the FDA or whoever runs the government street, they'll tell you that you must do that. But I do that because that's what I have to do. I don't have a choice in the matter. So I do the best that I can, and I get good results doing that. The kind of food I eat at that time of the night does matter. And when I prep for competitions and I want want my body fat down to 5%, I won't eat rich carbohydrates, but I'll eat lots of veggies. So I might have about 30, 40 grams of carbohydrates, but they'll be bound up with fiber, so much of it, that my insulin levels are just like, they don't rise sharply when I finish my meal.
So you're basically saying keep it simple.
That's
as long as you eat the calories, as long as you have the right
portion
of carbohydrate, just forget the other rules, just when you can.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
There's a lot of nonsense that people are trying to...
We've actually had that discussion because of the weight loss, and in particular also for Drew, that, you know, we were sort of laughing going, it's so simple, we've never eaten more food, and yet it's just healthy food.
It's funny,
and the weight's gone. You know, or
I love that. I love that because that's exactly what it is. I try to keep it as simple as possible. It's so it's achievable, okay? It's sustainable and it's healthy. Simple, no fancy trying to, because you can't keep to it. You just
all the rules change anyway. I've been on the planet for 52 years and the rules change all the time.
The rules change when you, as soon as you get something from the media, don't trust it.
Yeah.
What you want to do is find an expert who's been working in the field who knows exactly what results work with people. That's what you should be looking for. Okay.
I've got a question, David. Now that you've taken alcohol out of my life, are you going to take caffeine out of my life as well?
Very, very good question. And I sent you an email, I sent you what I want you to do with caffeine. Caffeine is a stimulant and it affects your adrenal glands. So if you have too much of it, it actually can hinder your fat loss and it will worsen your fatigue. Increases anxiety. So there's some negative effects of too much caffeine, but if you stick to about 100 milligrams a day, that's okay. It's like two instant coffees from home, like your instant coffee, or one small medium coffee shop coffee. It's about that. Okay. Green tea is very good that you can have as well. Also has caffeine in it.
So green tea, you have more of that? Or are you still limiting that as well?
You mustn't have an unlimited amount of these caffeinated drinks. You must, you know, find out how much is in it and try to not go above 100. See, the thing is, because it's a stimulant and it is available in nature, but it takes a while for your body to break it down. So it's like a half-life of 6 hours. So after 6 hours, the 100 milligrams you've taken in is 50. 6 hours from that is 25, 6 hours from that. But then if you have another cup, goes up to 150, 125, and so it just builds up in your body. And then that amount that's constantly circulating affects the adrenals. You have higher levels of adrenaline flowing through your body. Harder to lose fat because adrenaline pulls glycogen out of the muscle, turns into glucose. Glucose pulls the insulin out, and you can store fat. So there's like a real quick biochemistry lesson on that. But that's what's happening. So what I'm going to do is, I keep it simple. I just tell you, okay, don't eat more than that, or don't drink more than that. Nice and simple. You don't have to worry about the science. Okay, so last very important is prepping your food. It's so important.
Yep.
So important. Don't not have a plan. Not plan ahead. Don't have the food in the fridge, but it's not prepared. You need to have your food ready to go, because otherwise you'll just go, it's too much hassle, I'll just have some bread. That's what happens. Who of you?
They.
No, you don't know the question. Who of you have been in that situation?
Me.
And the rest of you are lying.
Yeah.
Okay? Because that's the way it works. We are lazy by nature. Our in us, we're just...
And tired.
We're tired, but that's right. So the laziness is enhanced. It increases when we're tired. So we want to beforehand prepare your meals so that you, unless you have time on your hands and you're at home and stuff, but so how long can you prepare food for in advance? Some people do it for 4 days. Some people do it for three. We always do 3 days. 3 days.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, it's good.
I do five and I'm still alive.
But she has five meals.
Three to five?
5 days in
five
advance.
Days.
I do on a Sunday for the whole week.
Like chicken in the fridge for 5 days.
Or just even just do my vegetables, yep. Then
you
sometimes check
vegetables?
Yep, on Sunday.
Melissa, you know.
Whole week.
Yeah.
Sunday for the whole week.
Snacks.
Nah, in the fridge.
No. Awesome. All right, so that I think I'm going to let Caroline know she can do 5 days.
Yeah. She's slacking.
I'll be like, in here, 5. It'll be a hard day.
You don't need to label it.
Guys, don't need to label it.
I don't necessarily want to cook for a week, but it's like what I need to do is know what I'm going to have for those meals, because I'm sort of winging it, you know, well, what have I got left to have for dinner?
Sure.
Whereas I don't necessarily think I need to cook it up for a week, I just need to know what I'm going to eat ahead of time for that week.
This is good. You must have this is why you've got to actually go and actually calculate it and put it in there and now try and do it. So once you've got this, what to eat, how much to eat, go and use your app, work it all out, set up a whole day in advance, and then prep your food for that, or know exactly, okay, that's what I'm going to have, if you've got the time to do it. Everyone is different. You're not going to have one system that's perfect for everybody. But I'll tell you a system that is effective. It's just you choose an hour twice, you choose a meal that you are happy to repeat. Okay? Give you an example.
I've got a question.
Chicken and veggies.
I do the week prep. Sunday prep for the week. But I'll do the snap lock bags and that way because I'm a tradesman, so I go from house to house and I just ask the customer if I throw them my way. But what I actually do is I freeze my meals. So I snap lock bag and put them in the freezer. Scrap out, put it in my lunchbox, take it to work, and it defrosts the other day, and it's like 2 minutes in the microwave, and it's boiling hot, ready to go. Is there a problem with freezing the food? Like, is it bad with the proteins?
The best way to eat food is fresh. Everybody knows this. The best way to cook is steamed. Everybody knows this. But keep it simple. Don't be like, I can't follow a diet because I can't steam my food. I can't follow a diet because I have to freeze. You do the best that you can in that situation, in every situation. You must take all the pressure and just, you must be like, I'm going to do the best that I can.
So if you weren't freezing it for the week, you may not eat as well because you...
I'm busy.
Yeah.
Pretty much, like, I struggle to get in here and do my workouts all the time. Yeah. And I'm committed this year, and that's what's convenient for me. That's
And that's perfect. What I'm keep doing.
Like, I've always had that problem with, I can't be bothered. I'll make it toasty or something like that.
Don't change something that's already working.
Yeah.
Very important. Yeah, and then extreme heat, extreme cold on food is going to affect the food, but you can't avoid it all the time. So, what was I saying for?
Pick a food you can repeat. Pick a meal you can repeat.
Done. Pick a meal you can repeat. And, you know, if you love chicken, then let that be the meal. If you love beef, let that be the meal. Let's say, for instance, you love beef, so you'll buy your beef. You prepare it the way you want, medium rare, however much. Salt, pepper, alright. Divide the portions up into your tubs, okay? You need a scale. You must use a scale, don't guess. When you're looking at food, that looks like 100 grams. It doesn't work like that.
I want that to be 100 grams.
You're like lifting the scale. So you'll need to measure what you eat. And so you set out your food. That's why if you reduce the number of meals you're eating, you'll follow it more easily. Because you'll have less tubs.
That's true. Sorry, can I just say something? I used to do like 6 or 7 meals a day. And then I stopped doing that so much harder. 3 meals is like better, and you don't think about food so much.
Yeah, exactly.
You don't worry about, oh my gosh, I've got to eat. Oh my gosh, what's the time I've got to eat?
This is what my clients are saying. All right? This is what I tell people, but it's my clients speak my language. They say what I say. So it's you're not thinking about food all day long. You're just, you know, okay, it's time to eat. All right, so...
And yet, David, just to counterpoint Robin, I found that as a teacher with my schedule, 5 meals a day was perfect. And then I was never hungry because I was eating, so I didn't think about food because I wasn't letting myself get to that point where I was hungry. And that was massive for me because, as I said earlier, I'd gone from eating nothing to having to eat lots. So
it works both ways. We've got to figure out what works for you.
It might be helpful on that Facebook page for everyone just to sort of share what they're eating and grab ideas.
Yep.
And,
yep. That's what it's there for.
Yeah.
And that's why we must make sure that everybody is on that page. Just finish this sentence. Hold that thought, though. And actually go, because I forgot now.
Thank you.
To count that again, like, I really agree with Dave on preparing three meals, but I can still prepare quite a large container and then split that in two.
Into your snack.
Yeah, into two meals, because sometimes I can't finish it. My body won't have enough and enough space. So I'll have a portion of that, and then I might get a 5-minute break later in the day and I'll actually finish it. So I can still do up to five meals, but the three is perfect for me, so
yeah.
I have that option.
Yeah, so again, yeah.
Sorry, I have two questions.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
It's not really about food, but I have to ask. Water intake.
Yeah.
And obviously it's important, but there's a lot of conflicting. Is it different for everybody based on your body weight? Obviously, like, the general rule seems to be 2 litres minimum, but then I've heard for somebody my size, more like 4 litres, 3.5, 4. Is that too much? I don't know.
Yeah, very good question. You need to, it's very simple. My system of intake of water is 5% of what you weigh.
Okay. Yeah, okay. So
very easy.
Yeah.
So simple.
Yeah.
5% of what you weigh.
So that's a lot.
How much do you drink,
Kat?
500 mils? How much do you weigh? 10 kilos?
Isn't also like
and that's
without that great pea colour.
Oh,
is
hang
a
on.
Indicator.
There's too much going on here.
And that's just water, right? So if you have a coffee or a tea or anything, that's not included
that's
in
not
that
water.
4 litres or no, that's.
No.
But it is water.
As if it's a herbal tea, I guess.
So, yeah, so herbal tea, the water from a herbal tea.
If it has caffeine in it, it doesn't count.
Okay, sure.
Was that Alsha?
I said your pea colour is a good indicator. Like, that's one of the, I think, easiest ones is.
Yeah, but to tell you the benefits of drinking 5% of your body weight is that every single, like, the trillions of set of chemical reactions in your body require water. That's why. Rather have the jugs full in your body and overflowing than not full.
Once your body's used to water, if you don't have enough in a day, you'll actually feel it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I have one more question. I am a bit terrible with condiments, and I know that they're bad for you, full of sugar and whatever. Do you have any like hacks, like good alternatives when it comes to condiments?
Good.
Yeah.
No, good. Can I come back to that?
Yeah, sure.
All right. So, I remember now what I was saying. So you take your protein, you've got your steak, you put it in your tubs. The next is your carbohydrate, or your fat's probably best to put in first. So you take your steak, you put it in your MyFitnessPal, you realize, it's got 10% fat in it, it takes my fat intake to this much, then I only need to add in a little bit of fat from some avocado. All right, there's a slice of avocado, put that in there. Okay? Then you top up with your carbohydrates. Why last? Because they don't really have a lot of fat or proteins in them. So they're not going to disrupt your first two macronutrients going last. And you add that in. So you could do, for instance, you could boil up some sweet potato. We do that. That's how Caroline does it. Nice and simple. In the pot, boils, takes it out, unwraps into the pot straight away. And there, now she's prepared those many days food. I like to add more to it. I like tomato, cucumber, celery, lettuce, or spinach leaves. All those extras don't really have a lot in them. I don't calculate them. You should right now. But in the future, you'll be able to guess, that's only going to be 50 calories if I have that, and that. Okay. So there, now you've got your meals prepared. Put them in the fridge. Off you go. Nice and simple. Eat one meal at home, one meal during the day, one meal at home. All right. Good question is the condiments. Now, yes, they are made with sugar, for sure. And alternatives are, they're
whole
not.
Whole egg mayonnaise was one.
What's that?
Whole egg mayonnaise.
Whole egg, yeah.
It's high in fat, but not so bad in everything else.
You can make it yourself, because I make only with egg yolks and olive oil.
Yeah. You know the worst thing about these things that you buy in the shops is all the additives.
Yeah.
Yes.
You know, it's not really the macronutrients, it's the other stuff.
Yeah.
It's like alcohol. Like just putting something in your body that doesn't belong there. So, and that's why you should avoid those things. But if you do have them, they've got so little, the amount that you use is so little that it's not going to affect.
Okay.
Like a teaspoon of tomato sauce may have like a gram of sugar.
Yeah. Okay.
Or 2 grams. It's nothing. But it's the other stuff which we're not going to go into. But that's another seminar on that specific thing, additives. Wow, we've got lots to do. But that's right. I mean, like Caroline, she buys bread for the kids, right? You know how long she's been searching for a bread that's suitable, that doesn't have 100 ingredients in it?
Mm.
And so she spent a lot of time, and she has found something that the kids think that's, and she feels safe. She feels good in giving to them. So with condiments, yeah, if you're going to use a little bit, if you've got like really dry chicken and you want to put some mayonnaise on it, I'm not going to say to you no. If it's going to mean that you're going to eat the chicken and not a burger from Burger King, not Burger King,
just
Hungry
add it
Jack's.
To your Fitness Pal thing.
And that's correct. You can add it to Fitness Pal, so it counts for your calories. And then another thing, the last thing before you can give me all your questions again, is herbs and spices. These things are, they're a blessing. They're so incredibly healthy. It's incredible when you research different spices and their effects on damaged DNA. That means that it's a cancer-fighting, cancer-preventing properties. Phenomenal. And they do all kinds of other things, like control blood sugar, for instance. Cinnamon is an excellent one to add into your diet. Controls blood sugar. You can add it to your water, yeah. It's just like, guys, spices and herbs have got like no, they're amazing. So use them. When I diet for the shows, I'm like in the cupboard and I've got turmeric and I've got chili and I've got cayenne pepper and I've got black pepper and I've got everything. Just, and I just like I want to taste all these things, and I put mixed herbs on, and so use it. It really makes a big difference. And the salt. Salt's another one, last one. Salt's fine to have, but be consistent with it. If you're going to have 2 grams of sodium a day, it needs to be every day. Not 2 grams one day and then 10 grams the next day. And you know what I mean? Don't let it be like a yo-yo.
She's a healthy salt.
Yeah, she's a healthy salt. But what I mean is the intake of sodium, it mustn't be changing. That's what unfortunately happens when you go for... when you're not following a plan, a healthy plan, preparing your food yourself and you're eating a takeaway, which has got heaps of salt in it, and then the next day you don't have a takeaway, so you've got low salt, and that's not good for your body. So you've got water retention, and you've got kidney trouble. You can see it's not good. So the best way to do it is to monitor your sodium and do the same. When I use salt, I use one of those grinders, and I will, depending on the season of my, if I'm out of off season, I know I'm eating more food, so I'll have less salt. My salt intake is going to be, my sodium intake is going to be higher in all the foods that I'm taking in, but in when I'm eating less calories, I'm having more salt. But I'm trying to keep my salt levels consistent. And I would have like 30 twists, that's okay, as long as you're consistent. Alright? I don't recommend that anyone has 30, by the way.
Yes,
whoa! Alright. So, but if you have like 5, it'll be fine.
Sorry, David, we have to.
Yeah, perfect. And that's it. So ask all your questions that you have, and then we are done.
Just a tip, so when I'm making myself, it's like if I don't want to add a dressing to it, I'll add things like parsley and thyme,
listen up, guys, this is very, very good, because Melissa cooks, like when I say cook, she cooks. She spends time cooking. She makes the food taste amazing. So she's got lots of ideas.
Mm.
And sage leaves are really good if you fry them up in a little bit of coconut oil, so they're like chips.
Mm.
Amazing. Zucchini chips.
Yeah, so you're in the group?
Yeah.
Good. Everyone should have fun. Yes.
I know, that's what I said.
So the other time when we were having this chat, you mentioned that you might approve shakes.
Protein shakes?
Yeah.
Yeah, shakes are fine. Best, like, the problem with the shakes is the additives, that's why I don't have a lot of them. Whey protein isolate is the best one from a dairy source. Casein is good at nighttime. And albumin, which is from eggs. Egg whites is probably your best one that you can get hold of. You get the pea protein, which are plant-based proteins. You can use...
You can still, you know, like load it up with spinach and almond milk.
You can make a meal, instead of having chicken, you can have protein powder. You can do that. But you can't use isogenics. Did you hear Kay? You can't use isogenics. That's the only one you can't use. Yeah, didn't get it. All right. Question? Another question?
Thank you.
See you later, guys.
Thanks, Ivan. Thanks, Ivan.